What happens when you flip on a light switch? Okay, yes, the lights come on. But how? Where are those electrons coming from, and how do they know to go to your light bulb? All right, you are probably wondering why I'm talking about something as mundane as a light bulb. But the thing is, that light bulb and the complexity happening behind the scenes on the electric grid is a key piece to solving the climate crisis. It's how we're going to mitigate the risk of extreme storms flooding our cities, avoid scorching the earth with severe drought, and ensure that our children and grandchildren inherit a habitable planet. But we need to rethink how the grid works and our relationship with it. We need to stop transacting with the grid and start interacting with it. But before we go talk about the future of the grid, let's go back to that light switch. When you turn it on, it closes a circuit that connects your light bulb to the rest of the electric grid. The grid senses this new demand, and somewhere, probably far away from your light bulb, a power plant generates just a little more power. That adjustment happens basically instantaneously. Across the whole grid, we have less than a minute's worth of storage. So the electrons flowing through your light bulb were produced just moments beforehand. As users of electricity, our experience is completely transactional. Flip switch, consume power, pay bill. We don't need to know how it works. It just does. But what happens when it doesn't work? What happens if that power plant doesn't increase its generation to meet the demand from your light bulb? Blackout. Not just for your light bulb, but across the whole grid. Now, historically, the grid has prevented blackouts a certain way. As demand varies over the course of the day, big power plants, primarily fossil fuel power plants, ramp up and down to match it. But that is not going to cut it if the grid is going to solve climate change. Right now, over 50% of the power flowing on the grid comes from fossil fuels. Producing that power contributes 1/3 of global greenhouse gas emissions. As is, the grid is a huge contributor to climate change. But going forward, it'll be an even bigger part of the solution. Now, the solution, it's not just as simple as replacing existing fossil generation with carbon-free alternatives. To solve climate change, we're going to need to electrify basically everything. Transportation, heating, manufacturing. By doing that, by electrifying everything, the grid becomes integral to addressing nearly 75% of global greenhouse gas emissions. But by doing that, we will double how much electricity we need. And all of it has to come from carbon-free sources. So the question, how do we solve climate change, actually turns into, how do we build and operate a grid without fossil fuels? Now, renewables are finally ramping up. Today, wind and solar produce roughly 10% of the world's electricity. But integrating that into the grid isn't always seamless. Before, the only thing we had to worry about was uncertainty and demand. But renewables add uncertainty and variability to generation, too. And that uncertainty causes high price volatility. Here's a simple example. A wind farm is happily spinning along, generating low-priced power. But suddenly, the wind stops blowing. And to keep meeting demand, another more expensive power plant makes up the difference, causing prices to skyrocket. Now imagine hundreds of thousands of wind and solar farms spread across the grid. That's the grid we need to solve the climate crisis. But it means that these price dynamics will happen millions of times over. We need to moderate these dynamics while preserving the stable and reliable electricity that we have today. To do that, we'll be reimagining how the grid works. Rather than ramping fossil fuel power plants to meet demand, renewables will be spreading across the grid, rapidly adjusting their production as weather conditions change. Electric vehicles will be acting as mobile batteries, drawing and then contributing power to the grid wherever they're connected. Smart thermostats and appliances will be making our buildings a little warmer or colder, or shifting the time of day that our dishwashers run to better match when power is available. Intelligent factories will be automatically adjusting their production, increasing throughput when power is abundant, and scaling back as prices rise. Massive batteries will be absorbing energy in periods of excess and returning it to the grid when supplies run short. The grid is becoming this interactional place, with all of these components working together to ensure balance and stability. But what's missing here is the underlying technology that ties all of these interactional components together. This grid needs a brain. Each device will be responsible for making its own decisions. Those decisions will depend on algorithms that predict future costs and availability of electricity. Just like we use weather forecasts to decide whether to bring a sweater, the pieces of our future grid are going to need price forecasts to know when to use or produce power. Because remember, if the grid isn't in perfect balance, blackout. For nearly 10 years in academia, as an undergraduate and then a PhD student, I studied what a brain for the grid might look like. It needs to produce rapid, hyper-localized, physics-based forecasts of grid dynamics across both short and long timescales. I wanted to confront the real world, competing values and interests, questions of political, technological, economic feasibility to make that brain a reality. So 3 years ago, I stepped away from academia. I co-founded the startup company Gaiascope, where I am now CEO. At Gaiascope, we are building that brain. By combining AI and physics-based models, we're building algorithms that anticipate the needs of the grid. Our algorithms will guide each battery, each thermostat, each factory to make the choices that keep our grid operating efficiently and reliably. Every day, I get to work on building this brain with a rockstar team. We're a group of software engineers, machine learning researchers, scientists, financial experts working across disciplines to create an intelligent backbone for our electric grid. We're not just talking about how to solve the climate crisis. We are actively building the solution. Now, the name of our company, Gaiascope, it's a nod to the Gaia hypothesis. That's the notion that all of life on Earth and the planet itself behaves as a huge single system, one that self-regulates to keep conditions favorable to life. It's a lot like an ant colony, acting beyond the awareness of each individual ant. And our future grid is exactly the same. All of our daily actions must work symbiotically to maintain a healthy, stable system. We have all the pieces that we need to solve the climate crisis, or at least most of them. We have batteries, we have renewables, we have smart thermostats. Now, we just have to bring them all together. But doing that requires all of us. It requires us to engage with and share this vision of our future grid. It requires us to stop transacting and start interacting with the grid. It requires us to become the grid. And we have to figure out how to do this together. Because if we don't, blackout. Thank you.